Everybody, how's it going? Hey, Bill.
Hey, Bill. How are you?
How's it going?
Pretty good.
Hey there, Bill. Brad Keith. See you once again at the old festival or a new place.
Chris, what's up?
Not much.
Play some banjos.
Any questions?
What song are you going to start with?
We've got a revolutionary idea for this workshop. We're going to play a tune together and then take turns.
Thank you.
Sound Creek that Bill made famous for playing with Bill Monroe.
Yes, sir.
I actually learned that tune from Don Stover and recorded with Bill Monroe in 1960-03.
Well, I think we should take turns, like you said, and who should go first?
You!
Hey, yeah, that works.
I thought of a couple of things to do that are different. In fact, I need to go first. I have a couple of new ones, so at this time I'll do both. But I'll just do one now. Probably the most famous person in the world who plays banjo, Steve Martin. He's not here, but he spent part of his time living in this state, and it was kind of neat that he, after thinking about it, finally someone got the urge to make a record of the banjo, and he has written a lot of interesting original tunes, and with the help of a whole nice cast of characters, including John McEwen, was kind of like the overall kind of main production dude, but Tony Trischka and I got called in also and did some playing on the record, and our old friend from Country Cookie Days and so on, Russ Barenberg's on playing guitar, Michael Daves and Brittany Haas. Interesting cast of characters, and a couple of things that Steve wrote that are sort of, I guess, songs in the making. And the one I'm going to play now doesn't have a title yet, but songs are tunes. Well, most of them are tunes, but then they're songs, in other words, with words coming along.
Yeah. That's what I meant.
Songs, yeah.
So, do you have a song that works?
That's a whole different workshop. That's
French philosophy.
Go down Route Stanley Street and turn right on Tim O'Brien Drive. That'll be that workshop. We have a chair for you, sweetie.
Honey, I'm fine.
Anyway, this is right at the very end of the demo he sent us of the tunes he's putting together. It was just a little half-minute segment that I thought was really just sweet as could be, and I took the liberty with his encouragement and permission to write a second part for it. So, and I hope it gets some words. To me, this suggests being a song, and we'll see what happens with it. If it's a song, it might have a name, something like Words Unspoken. Anyway, this is it. Oh. there's a lot more to Steve Martin than Wild and Crazy. And I think you'll really enjoy this banjo record. It has a lot of interesting variety of composition on it. Very musical. Okay, that was
Who's next on the cavalcade?
I'll go next.
Okay.
And I will employ your services, Bela. You want to do this tune?
Sure.
Okay. We're going to do a tune off of the Bluegrass Sessions called The Overgrown Waltz.
Bill has pointed out that it is on Bluegrass Sessions, not off Bluegrass Sessions.
A banjo workshop, not a grammar workshop.
The illustration of the differences between the different generations.
Now we speak English.
I should have been up here in the first place.
I'm not taking sides, I'm somewhere in between. If we could talk, then we wouldn't play the banjo.
Does everybody know Chris Pandolfi from the Boston? Thank you.
We were at Winnipeg last week for the Folk Festival, and Chris mentioned that he'd like to play that here, so we worked on it a little bit just now. That's Bill Keith.
Those are all new stuff. How about some old stuff? How about this? Well, let's see. You want to try some girl? I don't think I talk about bluegrass. So let's do a little. You got some tuners here, so why don't I try a little some of the other ones?
Thank you.
Any banter questions?
How does he count, like, when you do that tuning change?
When you do that tuning change.
When you grab the one knob,
bam, bam. When you grab the one knob,
bam, bam. Well, special little rises here that I invented.
Called Keith Tuners. And it stops the string, so you can turn it to a certain amount.
Gotcha.
Let's see.
Time for Bale to play one.
Yeah.
Mine with
yeah.
No, no. Your
turn. What one did you pick that you get to do? But if you have anything you do that's in your new movie that has the African factor going, that would be great time to hear that. Oh, you see that movie out of the church.
Okay, I got just a thing. There's a tune I learned. I'll play a couple of things, I guess. Or maybe, I don't know what I'm going to do, but I know I'm going to start with this. This is a tune I learned from a marimba player in Tanzania. The second one is one I wrote after hearing the thumb pianos in Uganda and Tanzania. That doesn't have a title either.
Okay.
So good question, though. Fantastic question.
What's the movie? I'll give you a brief thumbnail sketch. In 2005, in February, I went to Uganda, Tanzania, Mali, and Gambia to play with acoustic musicians in Africa and search out some of the roots of the banjo in Gambia and Mali in particular. And made a film with my brother, who was the director, and we brought a crew of about six people and recorded an album and a documentary, and it's been showing. The album's not out yet, it'll probably be out in February, and the film is showing at film festivals and has actually won three awards so far. It's going to be at Woodstock Film Festival, in my hope. Find out more about it by going to baylookalike.com and
tell about the title. I think it's a cool title.
Throw Down Your Heart. It's called Throw Down Your Heart.
And isn't there a certain
The reason we named it that was because when we were in Bagamoyo in Tanzania, that's the place where the slaves actually were shipped out from, but to the east. You don't normally think about all the slaves coming west to the United States, but these are the ones that went to all the Arab countries. And they said that when these captives would see the sea, they would know that they would never see their home again. So they would throw down their heart. So it's really a bummer title, actually. That's the story.
How were you damping in the first two? Was that all with the left hand?
Damping with my palm. palm against the, up in front of the bridge.
Palm.
What timing was the
first tune in? I have no idea. I mean, it's so, and the weirdest thing is, I mean, you can feel it like, but that's not where their beat was. Their beat was like one eighth note off from that, where the drums were. So when they hear me play, it sounds totally normal. But when you hear it with their rhythm, it sounds like something's wrong. It's a bar of four stuck in the middle of this other stuff. I have not figured out what it was. I just had to just write it out and learn it. But they know what it is, but they're not telling me. What's well, Jack, Chris?
Okay.
Yeah, do something for just this one.
Okay.
Let's see. It's a tough one. Well, I'll play a section of a tune that's on the first String Dusters record, Fork in the Road, called Moon Man. And it's kind of a cool banjo thing that I came up with when I was at Berkeley. I was working on playing, you know, different approaches to playing chord voicings on banjo, because the banjo obviously is pretty limited in that way. It's, you know, we've only got one octave across pretty awkward moments up here today. I'm just going to keep going with this, okay? So don't mind these guys right here. I should have said, compared to the guitar, the banjo has somewhat of a limited range. You've only got one octave across the string, so if you're... Can't argue with that, right? You guys... If any of you guys have heard the record or heard us play live, that's really just sort of the first part of the tune, and then it reprises and has another section in the middle. But the intro there is really you know making use of a really useful thing that I was working on when I was at Berklee, which is, you know, banjo players usually learn three sort of usual chord shapes: the F position chord, if you're playing a G chord, a D position chord, and then, you know, a bar chord. And, you know, you get a lot of mileage out of those, but you can also get a much wider spacing from the fourth to the first string if you play a low note with your index finger and a high note with your pinky. So if you notice that F chord in the middle of the song, those sorts of voicings also have a really beautiful sound, and they get you so much more range. They get you almost a wider, more colorful sound. So that's sort of where that tune came from. But you can pick up probably a Fork in the Road, the infamous String Dusters debut CD on Sugar Hill, the Red Fox Story. What you got, Pete?
I got a three chord song. In normal time signature. I'm a simple man, and like Chris says, he said it quite, you get a lot of mileage out of the good old stuff, and with a few twists to it.
That is so brave.
That's not gonna do it. When I was about 14 or 15 and discovered the banjo, one of the main tunings, if you had the only book available at the time, was the Pete Seeger book. It's so great that Pete Seeger is still with us. There's a fabulous film about him. The title escapes me. Somebody named the title? The Power of Song. And he sings his butt off, and he chops wood at the age of 80, whatever it is.
And he fights bad people. He
fights bad people with his banjo. And
like Senator McCarthy. Yeah. You know what we're talking about, the communist era. Yeah, he went through some serious stuff. He fought back.
For the folks here who are maybe just getting into the banjo, trying really hard to tune it by ear. I know we have electronic tuners still trying to. It's not the easiest thing possible on the banjo. And I had a little yard there in the Bronx that I was able to play in. And when I was practicing the banjo, I got into doing this. As far as I was concerned, there wasn't any better sound that could be made by a human being than that sound. I wish I could do that still, but anyway. So I'd sit there in the backyard and play that, and there's quite a few people in earshot if you live in the Bronx, and I thought, it's okay if they hear this, this is all right. And then when I saw the Titanic, and the guy in the Titanic said he felt like the king of the world, I said, I've been there. Anyway, so I can still get a lot of mileage out of my banjo and QC like this. And I have a little cabin down behind my house near a creek in Colorado. And that's where I go sometimes, even in the middle of the night, and practice and try to sometimes think big thoughts. I don't know, sometimes I just think about the sorrows in the world and all the good things in the world, a lot of big thoughts, like I say. And speaking of the sorrows, I have to mention this. Our good friend Artie Traum is very sick with cancer, and we're probably going to lose him soon. So anybody remembers Artie Traum from Artie and Happy Traum? I just wanted him to be remembered here in the part of the world that he lived and grew up and played a lot of great music and great guy. And anyway, we'll be thinking of Artie. Anyway, so this is just sort of a chant, more or less, that I do. And I've never played in front of people before except my wife. And We both like it, so we hope you like it too.
Range, and it's the first chord in this arrangement of hymn, A Mighty Fortress. Thank you.
Tunes you ever made up.
Yeah, I'm gonna just start improvising it, maybe not into a tune that I'm writing.
And then if it turns out good, you can learn it off of the YouTube that they'll be.
Okay, I'll play something for us.
Thank you. this, he didn't write this, but his version of this is one of our favorite banjo numbers. Fireball Mail, two chords. Play along, G and D. Oh, quick plug. Anybody wants to know about my banjo camps, left some flyers there. Banjo camps in Colorado, what fun. January.
See out there. Thank you.
So Bill Keith, Bela Fleck, Chris Gandolfi, who's about to go play at the dance there. And I'll keep working. Thanks a lot for coming, folks.
Okay.
Go for it.